everything changes, and at the same time, nothing changes. So what's wonderful about Buddha's teachings is that everything changes. Everything. How we perceive people, how we react to people, how we talk, our emotions, our happiness, our anger, our delusions, our jealousies, our successes, our motivations, our enthusiasm, everything completely changes, and yet nothing changes. Why is that? Because spiritual practice is basically change of attitude. So people who feel tired of spiritual practice, people who feel unenthusiastic towards spiritual practice, people who feel lazy towards spiritual practice, what happens is that most of these type of people don't find a lot of meaning in their life. They don't have meaning in their life, not because their life doesn't have meaning. They don't give their life meaning. So when we want to give our life meaning, as I've said many, many times in the past, it is not a matter of getting outer needs and wealth. It's not a matter of getting outer necessities. It's not a matter of any of that. Nothing. Nothing at all. It has nothing to do with outer wealth and outer betterment. If it had to do with outer betterment and inner betterment on just a very gross level, then we would see drastic changes in our lives. So we can see that we usually chase after one thing, after another thing, after another thing, after another thing, and we just chase and we pursue, and we call those goals. And in the process of chasing for those goals, we feel happier. And then once we get the goal, once we get it, we want another goal. We want to change goals, or we want a higher goal. We want a better goal. We want a different goal. And the whole life is after chasing goals. And so in the process of chasing goals, we lose our time. We lose our youth. We lose our friends. Sometimes we lose our partners. Sometimes we lose our people that are close to us. Sometimes we lose things that really, really matter in our lives. So when we chase after these goals, we have to understand that the goals that we chase after have to be legitimate, that they really do bring about some kind of stable, unchanging, and this is the key word, unchanging happiness. So what happens is, in spiritual practice, it has everything to do with everything about you changing. And the beauty of it is, nothing changes. Why? In spiritual practice, as you do more and more spiritual practice, real spiritual practice, transformative spiritual practice, you will see your mind become light. You will see your mind become very happy, very bright, and you will see that you accept things. Even in a few months that you're in the Dharma, in this case, this spiritual practice, even few days, for some people, few days, few weeks, you see your mind expanding. Example, things that you normally would not have been able to tahan, to take, to forbear, you're able to forbear now. Things that you thought, oh my God, I would never be able to do that. I would never want to do that. I would never want to be that, this, whatever. And that you have a projection. Even 1 week in the Dharma, when you listen to it, with your heart, with your intelligence, you say, I can bear it. And what does that indicate to you? When we open our hearts to the Dharma and we apply it, things that we were not able to do before, we are able to do. Things that we found unbearable, we're able to bear. And what's the big deal about that? You may think, well, I don't want to bear a lot of things. It's not that. When you are cushioned and your life is easy and you have things taken care of for you, of course it's very easy, but are we sure that it will always be like that? Are we sure? And even if physically we're cushioned, how about mentally? How about mentally are we cushioned? Because physically things may not change, but mentally in relationships with people, in finances, in stability, in job, in relationships, in friendships, does it remain stable? If it doesn't remain stable, outwardly we may have a big house and a big car and everything's nice and we're very cushioned. You know, we have enough to eat, everything is comfortable, everything is nice. But inwardly, are we cushioned? Inwardly, if we're not cushioned and we're not ready, the minute someone leaves us, the whole world falls apart. Our whole world falls apart. Our whole reality falls apart. The minute we lose some money, our whole reality falls apart. The minute someone says something to us that we don't like, our reality falls apart. The minute someone shows us a black face or an unpleasant word, our reality falls apart. And when our reality falls apart, we affect everybody around us. The way we act, the way we talk, the way we react, we hurt everybody and we damage. And sometimes the damage we do to people around us takes a long time to recover or never recovers. So when we do spiritual practice, it changes our mind. And it changes, how does it change our mind? It isn't that you pray more. It isn't that you meditate more. It isn't that you read more. It is a change of attitude, a change of perspective, and how we look at things. And how we look at things changes everything around us. And at the same time, the beauty of it is nothing changes. Nothing at all. Nothing. Why? We remain as we are, our identity. Male, female, Malaysian, foreigner. You like to eat this food, you like to go to sleep at this time, you like to wear this kind of clothes, you like this kind of fashion. You see, none of that changes, but your whole perspective and approach to it completely changes. Maybe 20 years ago, we would dress and look and do our hair and in a way, dress to kill, dress to seduce, dress to get, dress to conquer. But now maybe we're still dressing to kill, but now it's not to conquer or to seduce. Maybe now it's to invite, or maybe it is to impress people, or maybe it's to accomplish something. For example, we could have gone dressed before to look for nice girls in a club. Now we can dress that we can get a good job so that we can support our families. So dressing is the same. And the whole process of washing and grooming and shampoos and soap and water and toweling and cologne and perfume is all exactly the same. The whole process is the same. Nothing changes. Yet, what changes is the motivation and the object. So spiritual practice is the transformation of our perspective and how we look at things. That is spiritual practice. And then hence, the mantras are very powerful because the mantras are specific words spoken by Lord Buddha's holy mouth himself, which gather the energies in our body and the winds to help us, to bring us to this state of perspective that we can change our mind easier. And specific meditation postures, specific mudras, specific exercises, wind, breath, body, and mind that the Buddha has designed for our particular type of people in this world that help us to achieve that state of mind, which is a change of perspective. And that's what the mantras are all about. And that's what the sadhanas are all about. And that's what the meditation is all about. And hence, the meditational books, the Dharma books, and the study of the Dharma. The study of the Dharma is not Dharma. Praying is not Dharma. Altars and making offerings is not Dharma. Hanging around a holy guru is not Dharma. Not hanging around a holy guru is not Dharma. Having a great center is not Dharma. What is Dharma is the complete turnabout of our attitude and the way we see things and the way we perceive. And everything else is to facilitate that. Why? Nothing changes. Yet everything changes. And therefore, Dharma is pervasive, meaning everywhere. Timeless, which is applicable during Buddha's time and now. Whether you're living in a village during Buddha's time with no water, no plumbing, no electricity, no internet, no nothing. Just a hut. Or you're living in a great house in Bandar Utama with everything. It's timeless. And at the same time, it transcends all races, color, creed, barriers, levels. Classes. Why? Because all of us, in our own way, create or uncreate our realities and what we perceive. So therefore, a person who is stuck on being happy, that they have everything, they're happy, they're comfortable, that is their own creation. Because it's their own creation and it's not real, When something happens, their world comes apart. Similarly, a person on the opposite end of the spectrum who don't want to do anything, who absolutely don't want to do anything with their lives, and they consistently fail and fail and fail and fail. They fail not because of circumstances on the outside or inside. They fail because of their perspective of themselves and the world around them. So what happens is this, is that we listen to Dharma in order to get another perspective of a person who knows better, of a person who's experienced better, a person who's traversed and passed the difficulties we have passed. We listen to a person who has more wisdom, who has more skill, and who has a broader spectrum of thought, ideas, and methods. We listen to a person who basically is free from wrong perspective. And that person can only be a Buddha. No other being, a Buddha, can give us that method and that way to change our perspective. Therefore, if we listen to the Buddha's teachings, read the Buddha's teachings, visually see Buddha, such as in images, it can help to transform our mind. But I want to stress, as I've always stressed, and all traditions of Buddhism stress, that Buddhist practice or practice is not incense. It is not altars. It is not statues. It is not prostrations. It is not water offerings. It is not doing Dharma work. It is not charity work. It is perspective. Why? I'll tell you why. I'll give you a clear example. There are people in Dharma. There are people in Christianity. There are people in Hinduism, whatever, who are very mean, who are not nice at all. But they know the rituals. They know how to chant. They attend the classes. They read the books. But when they deal with people, they're exactly the same as they were the first day when they entered their religion. And then there are people in Dharma, in religion, in every religion, that when they enter the Dharma, from 1 week, the first time they hear their minister, their pastor, the imam, their guru, their swami talk about truth, you see their minds transform. Do you know how you see their minds transform? They are able to bear things that are not bearable. They're able to tahan things and put up with things that they ordinarily would not able to be put up with. I think every single person in this room are able to take things that ordinarily they wouldn't have been able to take. Think about you. Think about yourselves. Okay, I hate to use this as an example, but think about the first time you met your teacher and then now. How much were you cajoled, taught, compassionately advised, forced, yelled at, bribed, threatened, blackmailed into doing things now that you wouldn't have even imagined you'd do? Imagine, just think about that. And you know what's beautiful? There's a lot more coming. Isn't that fabulous? There's a lot more coming. Do you know why? Because you will reach a state where you can take everything. You can perceive everything. You can accept everything. And what you give back is not negative energy, but positive energy. And that every single person that comes to you will leave you happy. You watch people. Some people will go near them when we leave, we're like... Some people will go near them and go... Some people go near them, we feel silly and stupid. Some people will go near them, we're serious. Some people will go near them, we're like, what's up? Some people will go near them, we don't know what's going on. Some people, we go them, we leave them, we feel very happy. How we leave a person confused, happy, sad, unhappy, is the state of that person's mind. And what's their motivation towards you? So if we usually leave a person happy, that person's mind brings happiness to other people. If we leave a person confused, down, depressed, dour, angry, scared, that's the kind of feeling we are abiding in our mind. So if somebody comes near us and after they leave us, they're even more confused, we know that we abide in a state of confusion. If we go near someone and we leave them and we feel like, what's up with them? You know, you don't feel so good. You don't feel motivated anymore. Maybe you are very motivated till you talk to them like, ugh. You just, because why? They bring you down with their energy. Some people, we go near them. After we leave, we feel very angry. We listen to their perspective. We listen to their brain. We listen to how they talk, their views. And we go, ooh, why like that? And some people, we go to them and we leave and we feel happy. Not happy as in just jokes and jokes. Happy as in they give us something new to think about, a new way. And then we think, oh, I feel happy. So just think, when we listen to the Dharma even once, when we listen to Dharma two times, three times, 10 times, 20 times, we will see our mind expand and grow. Definitely. If the Dharma is authentic, the lineage is authentic, the motivation of the teacher and the students, both vice back and forth, are authentic, there will definitely be a transformation of the mind. Definitely. Even some people can come to a Dharma teaching angry and leave released. Some people can come anxiety and leave released. Some people can come depressed and leave happier. Some people even can come with a mind that's not sure, and they can leave happy. You see, we can't judge anybody's life. And we can't pinpoint anybody's life. And we can't say anybody's doing right and wrong. We can't, but the Buddha can. So if the Buddha can't, why do we take refuge in the Buddha? So some people can very, very much say, oh, you know, you can't judge me. You can't judge that person. You can't judge him. You can't judge her. Of course you can, if you reach a certain level of the mind. So don't speak for the whole population with your level of the mind. You can't judge, and you're in darkness, but it doesn't mean everybody else is. So therefore, there are beings out there. So the Dalai Lama comes along, or Lama Yeshe comes along and says to you, oh, you know, you're doing this wrong, and you should do like that, and that person doing like that. And you say, well, you have no right to judge me. Then who does? I mean, it's not right or wrong. You have to understand there are level of attainments in people's lives, in their minds. So the Buddha can judge us, but not in a Western detrimental way. Judging is a negative word, but judging doesn't mean judging as in condemnation or condemning. It means a comparison of what we can do and what we are doing. What we can and what we are doing. And that's what our guru is for. Our guru is there to let us know what we can and cannot do, and to cajole us, to inspire, to help us to do what we're supposed to do. Why? Why else would we seek a guru? I'm sure we don't seek a guru to fight with him. I'm sure we don't seek a guru to debate on and on for the next 20 years about what's right and wrong and get nothing out of it. I'm sure we didn't get a guru to punch us. I'm sure we didn't get a guru to get things out of him. I'm sure we didn't join our guru to extort him or blackmail or cheat or get something. I mean, that's not the reason we get gurus. We can do that to everybody else in our lives, and maybe we have. But that's not what we do to a guru. Why? He can offer us something more exciting. Much more exciting than blackmail and cajoling. What's that? A new perspective, a fresh perspective. Then we go, oh. So if you think about when you've entered and you listen to the holy teachings of Lord Buddha up till now, and if you've seen your mind expand and you're able to bear things that you normally are not able to bear, let me tell you, that ability from day one till now is Dharma. Not other people, whether they're practicing Dharma or not. Not your neighbors, not your friends, not anyone. But your ability to tahan, now listen carefully, your ability to tahan people who are not practicing Dharma, who are not doing spiritual practice, who are not good people, your ability to put up with them happily, continuously, is Dharma. So that's the secret. Dharma is not you enter a group and everybody's fabulous and they're wonderful and everybody's enlightened. No, that's not Dharma. What is Dharma? Dharma is how much the other person does to you within and without Dharma. You don't become discouraged. Do you know why? Because your motivation was never based on them. Your motivation was based for them, not on them, for them. If you made it motivation is based on them, oh, if they practice, I practice. Then, of course, your mood will go up and down. If your motivation is for them, then whether they're up or down, you're up. And you want to make them upper, higher. Definitely. So we have to think very, very carefully. When we're in Dharma, the proper motivation is essential from day one. Why is it essential? Because if you create the motivation for the sake of others, I will listen to the Dharma. For the sake of others, I will study the Dharma. For the sake of others, I will read the Dharma. For the sake of others, I will meditate and pray and I will put up with difficulties. For the sake of Dharma. Then you know what happens? You don't become depressed. You don't become angry. And you don't give up. Why? If we have someone we love very much, like our children, a brother or a sister, No matter what they do we give up? No. They can do anything. They can take all our money. They can ruin us. They can ruin our reputation, whatever. We never give up on them. I'll tell you why. Think about it. Because we're doing it for them. We want them to be happy. We want them to have a good life. We want them to have realization. So if it takes us 30 years to give that realization, even if we die and see them not realize, we, on our last breath, we will advise them, take care or do this or do that, or don't let that person cheat you, or don't go with that nasty girl or something. We will definitely say, even on our last breath, you know, you've seen mothers dying, you know, don't lose the crops, you know, don't forget to water the crop, and they die. Why is that? Because they have never lived on the basis of you. They have lived for you. So when we live for others, or we live on the basis of others, our attitude will be different. So people who get upset easily, or they go into the Dharma group and they say, oh, those people are all saints and I'm not going to do it. You're not doing it for them. You don't say, oh, I quit the group because they're all so wonderful. Because I've heard people like that. Oh, they're too advanced for me. I'm getting out of here. And then I've heard people also, oh, nobody there practices. I'm getting out of here. You see, that's the wrong motive either way. I'll tell you why. Because you're not practicing for them. I'm sorry, you're not practicing on the basis of them. If they're enlightened, there's another 5 billion people out there who's not. If they are not enlightened, well, join the rest of the other 5 billion people who are not. So our practice is not based on people or group. It is based on compassion for them, for others. So therefore, if we're not going to, if they shout at me, I shout back at them. If we have that kind of attitude, that's not a Dharma attitude. I'll tell you why. It's not a Dharma attitude because it doesn't benefit them or benefit us. Very simple. So when we want to do spiritual practice, it can't be on the basis of that, or on a basis, if I have this, if I have that, if I get this, if that person's like that, if the group is like that. Some people, when little things happen, they just drop out. They just disappear. They just gone. Why? Their practice was not for anyone. It wasn't even for themselves. It was on the basis of people. Maybe it was socially they can get together. Maybe it was an opportunity. Maybe it was for fun. Maybe it was for intellectual stimulation. Maybe it was just for benefit. Maybe it was just for, I don't know, let's see what happens. But people who do Dharma practice, not on the basis of, but for, their attitude will be different. The people who do spiritual practice on the basis of for others, they will not be disheartened. They can go through tremendous hardship. Tremendous hardship. And they will not be disheartened. They can go through severe beatings physically. And they will not give up the Dharma. As many people in Tibet were tortured, prodded by electricity, raped, emasculated, had their limbs cut off, beaten for them to give up the Dharma, and they would not. They would not. Because they didn't practice Dharma on the basis of, oh, if my country is fabulous and there's nobody around that's harming me, I'm going to be happy and practice Buddhism. No, because they practice for others, so they bore suffering. Example, when we went to Nepal, we met the great Tsawapoto Rinpoche, who stayed in jail for 20 years. Remember? We met him. He stayed in jail for 20 years, and he's a high-ranking Rinpoche, but he was made to clean the latrines, the toilet, of all the prisoners because of who he was. And he told me he happily did it. I said, why? He says, because I can absorb the sufferings of the three precious monasteries. I said, what's that? Ganden, Sera, and Drepung. He says that every single day when he woke up in jail, he prayed, may the obstacles of the monks and high lamas and the dharma to flourish in Ganden, Sera, and Drepung come to me. And every time I get a beating, which was a lot, every time I get scolded and yelled at by the guards, every time I'm told to clean the latrine, I will bear it happily because as I do it, I absorb their suffering and I absorb their consequences and I absorb the obstacles of Dharma, and I am the one doing it. And he says, that's why I remain sane, happy, and I recited my mantras. And he says, you know, there were times I was caught doing my sadhana and mantras and I was beaten and punished. So he says, I had to do it very skillfully. I had to lay down, pretend I was asleep, and learn how to do my mantras and prayers without moving my mouth. I said, did that make you unhappy? He says, no. He made it a little difficult, but I didn't become unhappy. And you can see he wasn't lying because his face is very bright and very shiny and very effervescent. And this is someone who teaches us Dharma by action, by example, not necessarily on the throne. So when we have a change of attitude and we do our Dharma on the basis of four others, you will not be disappointed. You will not be sad. You will not give up. You will never, ever let go. And you can bear all difficulties, no matter what is said to you, what is done to you, what happens. Even if you have to lose people, even if you have to give up people. Lord Buddha lost his parents. Lord Buddha lost his wife and his child, Rahula, his beautiful son. In ancient Indian tradition, your first son is a very big deal. Very, very big deal. As in the Chinese tradition, very, very big. And for him to lose his son and lose his beautiful wife, Yasodhara. Beautiful. She was the fairest in the land. And of course, how many courtesans can he have? And prestige and power and money, youth, his beautiful body, his fabulous hair, his great clothes, the elephants, the armies, and all that he stands to inherit from his father. Because these days, when we know our parents are rich, we're sitting there waiting for it. Now, when? When are we going to get it? When? And we live our life in such a way, when do I get it? When? The minute one of our parents pops off, you know, the traditional mourning, you know, because we get paid for crying, because we're going to get an inheritance, what? 49 days, chop, 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 omani peme home, see you later, hope they take a great rebirth, let's make a Buddha statue from KMT, see you later, mommy, see you later, daddy, can I have the money now? And we pay off our bills, we pay off whatever we want, we get our girlfriend, we get our boyfriend, we go out, we go to Australia, we go to America, we go to New York, we go to Honolulu, we go to wherever we've been dying to go. Thank God somebody died so I can not die waiting to go. And we don't actually think in that negative way, but subconsciously, it's there. Why? We've been thinking like that for many lifetimes. We're dependent on other people. We don't take responsibility. We want things. So that's natural. It's not evil, but it's natural. All of us in one way or another. All of us has leached off our parents in one way or another. All of us. So like that, every single person has been our parent. And every single person will be our parent again. And we need to repay the kindness of our parents in this life, past lives, and future lives. Why? Who's more equal kind to us? The parents of previous life, current life, or next life? It's equal, isn't it? So how do we repay them back? By changing our attitude. How do we change our attitude? By doing things for others. How does that repay their kindness? Because we collect great amounts of merit, and we don't collect negative karma, and we can dedicate that merit to all mother sentient beings. And therefore, we repay their kindness. Oh, yes. Every time we're aware, we repay their kindness. Every time we hold our anger and we reduce it, we repay their kindness. Everybody's kindness. Yes. Yes, Melvin was my mother once. Yes. Yes. Zahir was my mother once. A long, long time ago. I can't remember anymore. It was very traumatic. Yes, a long time ago. Millie was my mother once. Can you believe that? I came out of Millie and she fed me. And that time, I'm sure they didn't have bottle feeding. Oh, Millie was my mother once. And just visualize this one. Fat Monk was my mother once. Fat Monk. Monk Fat. Fat Monk. FM was my mother. I suckled Fat Monk's breasts once. And he changed my diapers and cleaned my lower parts. Fat Monk was my mother once. So I owe Fat Monk something. I owe everybody something. And therefore, when we practice Dharma, we practice for others. When you have that attitude, it's for others. You will never give up. And do you know what? You will not give up others as if you don't give up on your own children, on your boyfriend, on your girlfriend, on your wife, on your parents. You will not give up. I'll tell you why. A growing sense of universal responsibility opens up in your mind. Universal responsibility. And that is, I will bring happiness to everyone who comes to me. And whatever method employs, whatever I have to give up, whatever I have to sacrifice, more others are more important than me. Universal responsibility. And that's really wonderful. So the purpose of our center has always been, is and always will be, to help people get knowledge, to change their perspective. And whether they're Buddhist or not, it doesn't really matter. But to change your perspective, because then suffering becomes less. So hence, for all of us to be motivated to read our little Dharma books and watch our little Dharma CDs, it's a little difficult. Because for every single lifetime, we've been having a great time partying. And all of a sudden, someone comes along and says, what are you going to do when the party stops? It's a little difficult to stop and just get off the turnstile or just get off the podium and start, you know, meditating. So that's why we have a little Dharma center. We have a little half past six guru from Tibet who gently motivates us to study the Dharma. Gently. What are you smirking at? You want to slap? When I said gently, Zahir's like, you're being filmed, Zahir. Filmed. This is going to be televised all over the world, all right? You know how many millions of viewers in the future will be seeing this and your smirk? They're going to say, that one out. Bad guru devotion example, out. And then you know what we're going to do? They're going to see everybody's faces. Yours is going to be like digitally blocked. Would you like that? And they're going to have to double digital because your nose is a little long. So we need to do Dharma for others. For others. Please remember that. And so you don't come, when you do Dharma for others, you don't say, oh, they did that to me, that's why I'm not doing it anymore. They said that to me, that's why I'm not doing it anymore. I went there and Juan gave me a black face, I'm not doing this anymore. I went to KMT and guess what? Somebody was rude to me, I'm not going there anymore. Oh, they're not organized. They're not ready. They don't have money. They don't have a system. They're mean. They're rude. We all complain about that. Yeah. Welcome to samsara. And therefore, I'm not going to practice. Silly. Silly. Because you ain't going to find any place that has perfect practice. Anywhere. But if we change our attitude, everything becomes perfect. I'll tell you why. Because everything that we encounter becomes practice. Everything we encounter becomes practice. And that's why for Dharma practitioners like us who really, really want to make a difference in our lives and the lives of others, we will thrive on confusion, thrive on anger, thrive on mischief, thrive on nasty people, thrive on weirdos, thrive on people who are just totally out of it and that just test your patience to the end. We will thrive on it. Do you know why? Because they don't disturb you. Just think before Dharma and after how much you can tahan from people. Maybe before Dharma, if someone did something to you, you'd wallop them. You'd slap them silly, catch them in a parking lot somewhere and slap the crap out of them. But after Dharma, you visualize slapping them. You don't slap them anymore, just visualize. Then after a few more years in Dharma, you don't even visualize. You think, oh, poor thing. Oh, yes. So with Dharma, you know what happens? You know what's Dharma? Dharma is very beautiful. It's to protect us. Protect us from what? Doing more actions that harm. So the more difficulties we have, the more we have an opportunity to absorb and transform. And when we take refuge in the Holy Three Jewels, we are acknowledging to Lord Buddha, I will absorb other people's sufferings. Everyone's. I will take other people's suffering. I'm happy to take it. And along the way, I may fall down, but I will stand up again. And I'll fall down, I'll stand up again. But the point is, I stand up. That's what happens when we take refuge. So that's very, very important. I'm very, very happy to have these little classes because I enjoy very much sharing the Dharma with people. That's actually my passion. Besides reading and reading Dharma and videos and going to sleep early, my passion is Dharma and elucidating Dharma. I don't think of myself as a great Dharma teacher. What I think of it is this, is that for some reason I have some retentive ability of Dharma. I can remember Dharma quite clearly and well, and from many gurus and lamas. And I would love to convey this to all of you, because all of you haven't had the fortune yet to meet these lamas, or probably never will, because some of them have passed away. So I'm able to do that, and I enjoy it. I enjoy it. I don't know how to say it. I not only look forward to things like this, I enjoy it, I thrive on it, and I feel I've done something good with my life after I finish. When I go home from a Dharma talk, I actually sit there very high and very happy for many days. And I will talk about it with a few people around me, a few people who forces me to have my foot massaged. You know, I'm forced. They're like, please, can we make merit and massage your foot? I'm like, oh, all right, here. And so what happens is I'm on a high. Do you know why? Because I did something good with my life. I listened to the Dharma. I absorb some of it and I retain and I'm able to share it with others. And I feel really good. I feel very high. Nothing else makes me more higher. And therefore, doing VCDs and tapes and having a center and Dhammakan, all this, it's an extension of that. So I'm happy to be recorded and taped and then distribute it and encourage this in the writers group because I want the Dharma to go on. I'm not trying to be a star for the sake of a star. Because if I wanted to be a star, there's other ways to be a star. There's much, much better ways. Much, much faster and easier ways. Much, much better. And I would have done it 20 years ago, you know, when things were not prone to gravity. And that's all I can say. So my point is, so me wanting videotapes and VCDs and people and Dharma centers and also our outlets, KMT and ZMT and KP, is an extension of this passion to bring Dharma to others in any way, shape, or form, writing, visuals, verbal, speech. It's a passion to bring Dharma to others. And then when I talk to other people and when they do this, I feel passionate to talk to people who are passionate about that. Do you know why? I'll tell you why. Not because we share the same dream, because I admire that you also have compassion, that all of you have compassion. And I can draw inspiration from this compassion, that when we do Dharma work, we work very hard and we don't give up and we really pursue because we have compassion for others. So for even one person, I can become sick or whatever. Talk to them, advise. It doesn't really matter, or give, or help. Why? Because if that person can convey the Dharma to other people in some way, then my passion is fulfilled. That's my passion. And that's therefore, hence all the stores and the expansions and all, even these furniture are an extension of this. Because if people see this, they'll get attracted by this appearance. They come in, they want to know more, they learn about more, they ask more, and then they want to learn Dharma more, and they transform. All this is for Dharma. Why else? Why else? Even when I saw the Hiruka statues, the one without the flame, I flipped my lid. It was like I felt like an emperor going there and picking a courtesan and putting a red lantern. I want him in my room tonight. Last night, Hiruka was brought to my place and spent the night with me. I took pictures of him the whole night. And I MMS'd it to people. And today he was sent back again because I'm done with him. I want to fly to Nepal and I want to go buy, you know, 100 more Hirukas and bring it because I know the benefit and it's my passion. But if you tell me to fly somewhere else to do something else, I'll be very hesitant. Take me many years and effort to go because, well, I don't know. Maybe it's not in me. But the whole purpose of these gatherings and the whole purpose of getting together is to learn to do things for others, to change our perspective. To widen. That's the whole point. And that's why I'm very excited to do things like that. And I'm very excited to have people join all of us to do things like that. And I would like people who are effervescent, enthusiastic, and really like to do, and really take their own share and take their responsibilities, don't need to be pushed and prodded to do. Do you know why? When you're not pushed and prodded to do things, and you do things, and you do it well, you know what it is? You're compassionate, and you want to repay kindness. When you have to be pushed and prodded, you have to be forced, is a clear indication that you're not very compassionate and you have to become compassionate because compassion begets compassion. It's very simple. And if you make excuses for not learning the Dharma or doing the Dharma for any reasons valid, somebody was nasty to you, whatever, also it's not very good because then you're doing Dharma on the basis of something, not for something. There's a big difference when you do it for. And for the Dharma, for the Dharma. It says in the 50 Guru, verses of Guru devotion, Guru Panchasika, all of us should read that, especially if you've taken refuge. For my Guru, I can even give up my wife, my kids, my wealth. I can give up everything. You read that. That's not made up by crazy Tsem Rinpoche. I dare not. Imagine me asking somebody, oh, don't have a wife, don't have a girlfriend, do Dharma. Oh, I get slapped silly. I gotta look outside for booby traps. They'll get me. Yeah, there'll be a permanent Buddhist jihad on me. I know everybody's going to get me. Everywhere I go, everybody's going to be there. Forget about telling them to give up their wife and stuff. I just say, can you give up one night a week to listen to the Dharma, maybe 4 hours? Oh my God. To drag them here, to bag them, go there, drag them, cudgel them like Kali Rupa has a cudgel them, knock them out, bag them and drag them here and have them sit here and then give them jokes and give them fun, give them coffee, give them aircon, give them a nice room, give them a painted place, beautiful altars. Give them all this for them to come to listen to the Dharma. You have to drag them. They're heavier than a corpse. At least corpses just drag them. They hold on, you know. They don't want to let go. Oh, yes, it's very hard. And that's what a smuru or a real guru have to go through to bring people to the Dharma. It is a monumental effort. And even for one person, then you multiply that. Because each one of us, we have 108 reasons to kill our guru, to get him. So imagine if our guru says, do you think you can go vegetarian for 1 week? And then he got a duck, you know? Oh my God, because you throw a lamb chop at him. I'm not going to go no vegetarian. I've been eating meat my whole life. Then if he says, then if your guru says, do you think you can drive beyond 10 minutes to get to Dharma? But I live in Shah, Egypt. And it takes me 5 hours to drive there, and I'm not going there. And then some people are like, but I didn't eat din din. I can't go to the Dharma talk. I didn't eat din din. Oh my God. Or some people, I think tonight I'm going to get laid. And then there's some people, oh, but I'm sleepy. Or some of them, they profess they have bird flu. They go, achoo, I got bird flu, I can't make it. I'm like, what? Why? Because they looked at a map of China, so they were, you know, they got bird flu. I'm like, oh yeah, that makes a lot of sense. And the other people, well, there's someone in Dharma talk that I don't like, and they disturb my mind, so I'm not going. I'm like, oh God. So many excuses. So imagine a guru asks you to come to the Dharma talk. You know how much effort it is on his part? Because he's asking for it. And that's just you, one. Imagine you multiply that when you have Dharma talk, how many people he has to deal with, how many SMSs and messages that he has to deal with, to the excuses. And that is just to help them. And then that's just small things, you know, skip din din, be a little late, be a little sleepy, maybe your lover screams at you or whatever. But, oh, heaven forbid, if you ask them to give up their wife or their husband for the Dharma. Oh my God. Oh my God. They're going to be wearing I love Osama bin Laden and Tsem Rinpoche t-shirts. And you know what that means. They're going to come look for me. The irony of I love Osama bin Laden, these shirts, you know, everybody hates him, but they wear it just to taunt him. Couldn't you see? Next year, you're going to see me in trial somewhere in America, and I'm going to be like Saddam Hussein. I was pulled out of a cave, and I'm overgrown in beard and hair, and I'm like all disheveled, and you know, he made me study the Dharma. He did. And all of you being the witness, and yes, he made me study the Lam Rim, and then flying Lam Rim. Oh. And then the judge, of course, is Henry sitting there going, order in the court. There will be no more throwing Lam Rim books at the defendant. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine the guru there telling them to live their life differently? If I tell a student to live their life differently, do you know how much reaction I get back that's negative? If I tell them that they might be wrong, they already like, you know, they take the noose and they wave it at me. Because I know what's going to happen to me when I go for the little boy's room. Rinpoche found dead in toilet. Can you imagine that? Imagine if I ask people to change their life, skip din din, transform themselves, give up something. And you know what? I wouldn't dare ask for anything like that. No way. None of us are at that level. If we were at that level, we wouldn't have to give up our wives and husbands anyways. We would have no attachment. We can be without attachment and happy. Oh no, no way I would dare do that. No way. And these days, see, during Buddha's times, the gurus walked around and the students tiptoed around him. These days, the gurus got to tiptoe around the guru. No, the gurus got to tiptoe around the student. Can you imagine the tiptoe? Imagine his toes like Baryshnikov, you know, always on like, you know, ballet time. I went to see the podiatrist today, by the way. Oh, yes. And then if you ask someone and you try to ask them, can you please SMS me back the result, please? I'll give you coffee bean money and I'll be nice to you and you get to go home early and, you know, oh, no. No, 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 no. To ask someone to do something for you, no, it's a big no-no. So if you tell them to change their lifestyle, if you tell them to do something wrong according to the Dharma, the yardstick of Dharma, you'll get it. You'll get it. Never mind asking them to sacrifice things that will bring them more harm. Even when you can see clearly by logic or sometimes by divination and sometimes by Dharma, you can see clearly they're going the wrong direction. And if you tell them something, they will think of 108 ways to justify what they're doing back to you. And they will get you. And they will justify it to people around you. And they'll keep talking and talking and bitching and complaining. Do you know why? Because they're not doing things for others. They're doing things on the basis of others. If I get this, if I get that, if I get this, if I get that, then I will do this. Then therefore, it doesn't constitute Dharma practice. Why? There's no transformation. So those type of people, they're not bad, but when something happens, they will suffer tremendously. Why would they suffer tremendously? Because they didn't do Dharma for others. They did it on the basis of others. Big difference. Big difference. None of us can check what we're doing and compare and judge other people's lives, but we definitely can set them in the right direction, because judge or set them in the right direction is just different words. Otherwise, there will be no Buddha. There will be no gurus. There will be enlightenment. And there will be no attainments. That was to say that no one has attainments on this planet. No one. Then why have a guru? Why? Why prostrate to a guru who knows less than you? No, wrong attitude. So the purpose of Dharma talks and this class, let me tell you why, is that we can get Dharma knowledge to change nothing, yet everything. And hence, we have these classes. I enjoy it. I look forward to it. And look at the beautiful place and look how comfortable and nice it is. You know, for us, our group, always something nice manifests, a nice center, nice place. Everything manifests to receive the Dharma. So today, I wanted to give you that motivational talk that I want you to have a fabulous motivation to do today's test, because there is no failing and there is no winning. Read it, think about it, and write from your heart, and afterwards we have a discussion. It is to learn. And don't ask this person, don't ask that person, because if you ask, what's the point? There's no point. So what we're going to do is we're going to go through each question individually so that everybody, whatever language you speak, Smirman, Smimese, Smentonese, Mandarin, whatever it is, we can translate into 40 languages, you know, UN here, so that you understand, so that during the test, we don't have people, do you know what I mean? And it's very interrupted because there's other 20 people trying to write and there's the ashfashfi, ashfashfa. And he says, no cheating. I'm not cheating. I don't understand. Oh my God. So we're going to go over the questions first. And then we have people like, when we're just about to write our answers, then we, ching chang chang, ching chang chang. And then you ask, hey, ching ching, what's wrong with your chang chang? I don't chung chung. Oh. And it just gets on your nerves, and just when you're about to write the answer, and then you hear someone going, wahi, wahwa, wahu, wahwa. And then by the time they finish translating to you, you forgot what you want to write, and you want to strangle that person. But of course, it's out of compassion you want to strangle them, so that they don't have other people strangle them, right? So that's what we're going to do. We're going to go over that. But before we do that, what's beautiful is, these are the questions, and they're very fun, and they're very easy. We're going to write it down on a separate piece of paper. See, Melvin can't let go of his pen. He's dying. He's like, come on, let me write that paper. Hurry up. I'm so excited. I'm going to write double. I'm going to write triple. And we'll have 1 hour to do it. And while you're doing it, Rinpoche's going to sit here in deep samadhi meditation with a stick. And then before we start our test, we're going to do a little prayer to Buddha Shakyamuni. Why? This is the Dharma activity. It's not a test. We're going to do a little prayer to Lord Buddha Shakyamuni. And we're going to ask him to bless our minds, to open it up that the Dharma can enter. And then we'll do his mantra 21 times afterwards. And then after we do the prayer to Buddha Shakyamuni, we're going to do his mantra. After we do his holy mantra, how lucky we are. How lucky. Then we're going to elucidate on the questions. Then 1 hour after that, we're going to do a discussion and we can get out of here because there's a lot of Cinderellas here. A lot. And some Cinderellas make it late to the ball. But we won't mention any names, will we? But I'll give you a hint. Their name is Zahir. Sure is rude. Do you think that hint was a little too subtle? Oh God, I tell you. And some more. Some people on the way here late will not SMS or inform the smoodoo because he's just a doormat. When we call up, it'll go straight to message. And then they'll give us some lame excuse that their battery's out. Oh my God. Yes, I've heard it all. All right, just traffic, timing, work, I understand. And you know what? It's so weird because you're probably thinking your karma came back to you. You're perpetually late. You've been late all your life. I know. I was sitting there in my room thinking, oh, okay, absorb it because it's my karma coming. I'm perpetually late. So this time they're late. They got me back. We're even, Steven, okay? No more revenge tactics. Thank you very much. So everybody will get one wonderful sheet here. How exciting. And let's do a prayer together. Then we elucidate questions and we write it. This is really fun. Really, really exciting and fun, all right? Ufakazi! here. This Ufa Gassin, you pass out here. Smelvin Gassin, you pass out that side. Oh, okay. A daily prayer for blessings, protection, and auspiciousness. Praise the Buddha Shakyamuni. Let's read together. Praise the Buddha Shakyamuni. O Blessed One, Shakyamuni Buddha, precious treasure of compassion, bestower of supreme inner peace. You who love all beings without exception are the source of happiness and goodness, and you guide us the liberating path. Your body is a wish-fulfilling jewel. Your speech is supreme purifying nectar, and your mind is refuge for all living beings. With folded hands, I turn to you, supreme unchanging friend. I request in the depths of my heart, please give me the light of your wisdom to dispel the darkness of my mind and to heal my mental continuum. Please nourish me with your goodness that I in turn may nourish all beings with an unceasing banquet of delight. Through your compassionate intention, your blessings and virtuous deeds, and my strong wish to rely on you, may all suffering quickly cease and all happiness and joy be fulfilled. And may holy Dharma flourish forevermore. Te ata om muni muni ma muni shakyamuni e soha. Te ata om muni muni ma muni shakyamuni e soha. Te ata om muni muni ma muni shakyamuni e soha. Te ata om muni muni ma muni shakyamuni e soha. Te ata om muni muni ma muni shakyamuni e soha. Te ata om muni muni ma muni shakyamuni e soha. Te ata om muni muni ma muni shakyamuni e soha. Te ata om muni muni ma muni shakyamuni e soha. Te ata om muni muni ma muni shakyamuni e soha. Te ata om muni muni ma muni shakyamuni e soha. Te ata om muni muni ma muni shakyamuni e soha. Te ata om muni muni ma muni shakyamuni e soha. Te ata om muni muni ma muni shakyamuni e soha. Te ata om muni muni ma muni shakyamuni e soha. Te ata om muni muni ma muni shakyamuni e soha. Te ata om muni muni ma muni shakyamuni e soha. Te ata om muni muni ma muni shakyamuni e soha. Te ata om muni muni ma muni shakyamuni e soha. Te ata om muni muni ma muni shakyamuni e soha. Te ata om muni muni ma muni shakyamuni e soha. Te ata om muni muni ma muni shakyamuni e soha. Te ata om muni muni ma muni shakyamuni e soha. Te ata om muni muni ma muni shakyamuni e soha.